Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Lilkindy. We hope you stick around. Our look back today takes us to the year of 1998. Fast forward 20 years, and this is what he's doing now.
President, I believe it's time for a vote on a veto override, and we just need the direction that the bill become law, notwithstanding the veto of the governor, and then read the last section. So everyone who voted unanimously for this bill can now vote whatever way they want to override the veto. So we just need that direction from the chair.
Senator DeFrancisco, I'm well aware that you're looking for that direction from the chair, and I'm not prepared to give it at this particular moment.
Well, I'm not quite sure. Under what rule do you rely on to basically do what you want to do rather than what the rules provide?
I'm prepared to take this up at a later time.
Well, this is the time to take it up because this bill is before the House. It's a bill of Senator Carlucci sponsored by bipartisan sponsorship, and everyone voted for it. We would like that to be announced at this point in time, or if you choose not to, we could have a member of the Senate take the chair to give that direction, which is required by the rules.
I'm just going to review it one more time before I take the steps you are requesting.
Senator DeFrancisco, you were criticized afterwards by some to be mansplaining to the lieutenant governor. Take it from here. Talk to us about what happened in session last Tuesday.
Well, there was even more to it than what was indicated right there. There was two parts. So the lieutenant governor came in, and as she has a right to, she's the presiding officer over the Senate. Neither she nor any other lieutenant governor since I've been here in 26 years has ever been at the chair more than two or three times. But I think there was an opportunity that the governor found that we had an even split, Republicans and Democrats, because one of our members, Tom Croce, he was a reservist, went on active duty. And I think they were thinking they were going to be in a position to have the governor break ties on the thing. So that's what the scenario was. What happened just then is that we kind of shocked everybody by putting a veto override of one of the governor's bills that passed unanimously in the Senate. And that is what happened just then. And the governor, lieutenant governor, is basically resisting taking a vote on it. I'm sure on the theory that she didn't have any direction from the governor, and she had no idea what she's supposed to do, and she didn't want to embarrass the governor. So I can understand the position she was in, but the rules are the rules. And ultimately, there was a happy ending because she did read the last section, and we unanimously overrode the veto of the governor. The second part of it was even more critical, and that part dealt with amending a bill. And she had to make a ruling on that as well.
Mm-hmm. So what bill was it?
Well, a bill was a bill dealing with some animal rights bill. I know we had a ton of them on that day for some reason. But in any event, the Democrats...
it was Animal Advocacy Day.
Yeah, put on an amendment, wanted an amendment to the animal rights bill that would provide expansion of abortion rights in the state, and allowing that amendment so there'd be a vote on it, and included late-term abortions, and it also included non-physicians being allowed to do abortions, it's labeled as a woman's health bill, which is still beyond my comprehension. But in any event, the motion was made, and then at that point in time, we agreed to it, even though in order to make an amendment to a bill, it has to be germane. And the reason it has to be germane is you can't put an animal rights bill on and put something totally unrelated. Otherwise, the whole process of committees and everything else would be a sham if you can do that on any bill you want to do. So, but again, they weren't ready for this. I moved to accept the amendment, and then we were just going to table the bill because I felt that if there was going to be a discussion about it, no doubt she would have found it germane, even though it wasn't, the two totally polar opposite bills. Mm-hmm. And then there would have been a battle on the floor, and it would have been havoc, and it would have been dysfunctional. And it was our feeling that we didn't want to get into that. Well, despite that, this Lieutenant Governor recognized Senator Krueger, who wanted to speak about the abortion bill. Mm-hmm. So I jumped up, or I didn't jump, but I got up from my chair and I said, you can't talk on an amendment that has already been, the bill's been amended by consent. And she argued with me about that, and she wanted to say that, well, I've already recognized her. And I said, well, whether you recognize her or not, the rules are explicit that once the bill's amended, it's got to be laid aside because it's not live. It's got to wait for 3 days before you can discuss it again. So we had a little back and forth. That also probably prompted the mansplaining remark, which I'll get to in a minute. But eventually she agreed, and Senator Krueger sat down. Because what I did was, okay, if you're going to provide this, if this is the process, we're going to move to withdraw our agreement to the amendment, because you just can't have it both ways. And so I did, and then there was more discussion, and ultimately the amendment was never put on, because what I did then was I made an immediate, called an immediate meeting of the Rules Committee to discuss other bills. And that lasted for two or three hours before we got back again, because everybody's, what are we gonna do? What are we gonna do, both sides? And it came back and we just adjourned. And fortunately, we didn't have a big hullabaloo on the Senate floor. And what we ended up doing was there was discussions between the two leaders, Senator Stuart Cousins and for the Democrats and John Flanagan for the Republicans. And they agreed on a bunch of bills that we would put on jointly, both sides, which we had agreed to before anyway, and to try to smoothly pass bills. The next day, after accomplishing no bill passage because of what happened, but the next day we passed 200 bills.
Wow.
So
I didn't even realize.
And then we went back with the Lieutenant Governor another time, but when she was there, nothing happened. When she wasn't, we got bills, tons of bills, hundreds of bills passed. So that's what happened. Now, the mansplaining needs splaining, okay?
Yes, it does.
It needs splaining.
It's kind of an annoying word.
Well, I didn't know what the heck it meant, to be honest with you. So after this was over and we were going into the Rules Committee, the press stopped me, and basically the TV cameras were on. They said, you know, what do you think of the remark about some women's groups that I was mansplaining to the governor? And I basically just said, look, I that's supposed to be sexist or something? Because I really, truly didn't know. And they kind of chuckled and said, yes. I said, well, look, I don't care whether it's a man or a woman who's presiding. Both have to follow the rules. And that's all I'm doing. I'm the floor leader. I'm supposed to have civil debates and run the floor so that we could be in a position to get things done. And you can't just decide to do what you want to do despite what the rules say. And it ended up with a happy ending, at least till this point in time. And that's basically where we're. And quite frankly, I know the Lieutenant Governor. We get along extremely well. And my thought is that I have too much respect for the Lieutenant Governor in order that I would treat her differently because she's a woman.
Right.
You know, I mean, that would be sexist, I think, because she's a woman, I would decide that I'm going to speak differently or come up with a different position. That's ridiculous. And so hopefully we've had another very successful day, a couple hundred bills passed. Today we've got a couple hundred bills on the calendar, and hopefully the Democrats are happy with the number of bills they're getting, and we go on hopefully to a successful conclusion in the Senate, and then we can beat up on each other during the election season, which will definitely happen.
Mm-hmm. So legislative session is on Channel 83 and nysenate.gov. If anyone wants to watch these proceedings, it's kind of better than a Netflix subscription right now.
It depends on the show, though.
Okay, so the trial, the Governor Cuomo's Buffalo Billion, that trial is about to begin soon. And I want to move on to the need for transparency with taxpayer money that's invested in state economic development programs, your bill to give the comptroller more control in state contracts. We also talked about a need for a database to have all of these things together so people could view them. And you told us about the $90 million for an LED factory in DeWitt that never came. So now I want you to tell us about the film hub.
All right. I just want to mention something about those trials, though. It just came, it's hot off the press, that the prosecutor just dismissed one of the counts against the Syracuse Contractors Core Development and Steve Aiello, and dismissed another count against Simonelli in the Buffalo Billion area. And, you know, this is kind of amazing. You know, you throw everything but the dishwasher, you know, all the what do you, what's the phrase?
Throw the baby out with the bathroom.
Well, you throw everything against the wall and hope that they'll plead guilty.
Spaghetti.
And they think they're going to plead guilty at something because they got so many charges. Now, as we're going closer and closer to the trial, charges are being dismissed voluntarily by the prosecutor. If that doesn't show some kind of bad faith, like the charge that Steve Aiello lied before to the prosecutors, they dismissed that.
Oh.
You know, so I don't know what's going on, but I think there's a realization that they were overcharged, all of these people. But there's still going to be a trial, and whatever happens to the trial, it's totally up to the jury. But with respect to the transparency, we don't want this stuff to happen anymore.
Right.
And that's why we put these bills in, and the other procurement bill that we passed in the Senate, the Assembly hasn't even taken up. And the Assembly hasn't taken up the override of the veto, even though they, I think, unanimously voted for the bill that we overrode in the Senate.
But they said it was already discussed in the budget.
That's baloney, okay? That's baloney. So, when we get accused of playing politics, these are good bills, but they obviously don't want to offend the governor because there's a concerted plan to make an all-Democrat government by next November. So that's basically what's going on. Now, as far as the film hub, to get to your point, as far as the film hub is concerned, the state spent millions upon millions of dollars for the film hub, and I knew it would never work because the people they claim were going to come in and run it were fly-by-night operation out of California. And I told the head of economic development, I told Kelly Arrows, I told the developer, and they did it anyway. In any event, nobody's there. They don't have anybody to put in. And so the state said, well, why don't we let the locals take this very valuable building with a lot of ability to do films and let the county government run it. And we'll give you, I think it's $200,000 for the first year so you can get operations going. And there's some capital money as well. So I was called, being a critic of a lot of these economic development projects, and I was called by the County Executive Joni Mahoney, would I have any objection to it? And I said no, and it's a valuable asset, and it just seems to me that if you got local control, you at least have a better chance of getting it used and being used effectively rather than out of New York City or Albany. And so, and I said also, kind of tongue-in-cheek, that the price was right, $1. And so the county is a valuable asset, and if they can't manage it, then at least we gave it a try because it's obvious that the state could not.
Mm-hmm. Unfortunate.
It is.
So now onto public safety. Last month we talked about the parole board's decision to release a man. The Palm Sunday massacre killed 8 children, 2 mothers, and also Herman Bell, who was a 3-time cop killer. And sometime this month, another man convicted in those same police murders will be going up against the parole board. His name is Anthony Bottom, and you are asking, what message is this sending?
Well, it's the message you're sending is you can do just about anything, and you're going to be let out on parole rather than stay in jail for the maximum term in view of what the heinous nature of the crime, a bombing, one case, killing police officers, another case, now another person was involved in that police killing. It's outrageous. And the board, you know, the governor can say all he wants, well, it's the board's, their independent decision. He's the one who named the members of the parole board. And he certainly must have known their philosophy before he did it. So to just walk away from it and say he had nothing to do with it. And we've been trying to overturn those decisions, but whether we can or not, and even to add insult to injury, the governor just recently ordered the parole department to provide him the names of people going out on parole, and he issued an executive order to present those names to him so that he could allow, by executive order, these 24,000, I think the number was, to vote this November. You know, you really have to be kidding me, because it's so transparent. That's the only thing that's transparent about the governor, transparent on how he uses his office for political purposes, no matter what the consequences may be. Mm-hmm. And so the message is wrong, and the message to me is that it's time for new leadership in the state of New York.
And now this brings us to our look back, and we're looking back 20 years right now to when the Senate passed your bill, Jenna's Law, that would eliminate parole for violent offenders.
It's an important bill. The crusade has been brought to us by both Bruce and Janice and their daughter, Erica. The reason is that it should be passed is because it's the right thing to do. No doubt many of us will argue that there's too many people in jail. We should have alternatives to incarceration. We should have situations where we can reserve the jails, the overcrowded jails, for those who should be there. And this House has stood repeatedly for the proposition that the violent criminals are those who should be there. And the fact that work release has been stopped for violent criminals and the crime rate is going down in the state of New York, the fact that New York City, rather than being the crime capital of the world, is now being visited by police commissioners from throughout the country to find out, how did New York City do it? How is New York State doing it? The answer is very simple. We stopped violent felons, with two violent felonies, from getting out on parole. Now it's time to go that next step. Had that next step been done a couple of years ago, who knows what would have been the fate of Jenna. Her parents definitely believe she'd still be here today.
Who was that?
You have a similar style still.
Still. Maybe it's more energetic back then. But it's interesting because that was a huge bill. Mm-hmm. Jenna was killed by a person who was out on parole that was a violent felony offender. And, you know, and her parents did a crusade that actually, after the Senate passed it, the Assembly went home and wouldn't pass the bill at the end of the session. They were able to get so much public outcry that Sheldon Silver, for the first time ever and the last time, brought the Assembly back to pass the bill because the heat was on. That was lobbying at its highest in the history of the state Senate. And now it's law. So people, it's the direct opposite of the trend that's going on right now. Governor Pataki was the governor then. Giuliani was the mayor of the city of New York, much tougher on crime. And now we're going back to this Wild Wild West situation. Let everybody out of jail. Let everybody vote who's on parole. And this is the wrong trend. That's why that trend has got to stop.
I hope it doesn't affect the future too much.
I hope not.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being with us, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For additional information on what we discussed today, defrancisco.mysenate.gov.